before we have to vigorously polish the Radio Flange Goblet mascot Sloth, we've just got time for what shows you can expect to listen to this coming summer season on Radio Flange Goblet. Put that down, Jeffrey. You'll have someone's arm off.
Sorry, Uncle Spillage.
On July 14th, look out for Puffin vs. Herring, a new four-hour debate show where Arnold Puffin and Billiam Herring go beak to fin on the hard-hitting subjects of the day. No limit is off the table. The show gets racy, obnoxious, and at one point they wheel in a cupboard with Muriel Hemingway in it and flagrantly ignore it in favour for some mouldy ham. Then on July 22nd, it's All in the Basket, Matron, a hilarious sitcom set in 1950s Cleethorpes, where Patty Flappy Baps heads up an all-star cast of mostly retired pier mechanics and a magician that wears novelty waistcoats and makes off-color remarks about immigrants in a grating regional accent. Working in a navy laundry, scrubbing the gussets of many a brave seafaring gent, it's double entendres of plenty when Matron and the gals are in town. You can't move for innuendos about naughty bits, I tell you. It doesn't get at all tedious. Not one bit. And finally, on August the 6th, it's Jeff Lynne Week. Jeff Lynne and his reunited cello host a series of favourite Jeff Lynne moments, including the time he told Ringo the story about the time when Roy Orbison coughed up an egg roll onto his Jeff face, and another incident where the synth tuba player for ELO got sick during a particularly lively and unasked-for rendition of Mr. Blue Sky on an Atlantic voyage, and so they just hurled him overboard and his part was filled in by some blind children that had accidentally stowed away aboard the ship thinking it was a Woolworths, the now-defunct high street staple that couldn't buy to figure out just what the arse kind of shop it was anyway. Also, Jeff Lynne will be screening some of his favourite George Harrison movies and talking about them, presenting a slideshow of corduroy shoes that he's owned, and a three-part documentary on where he buys his hair. It's all this and more this summer on Radio Flange Goblet. And now, you know what time it is. It's time for the after-movie diner. And during this episode, make sure you listen out for the customer in the background who dies of chronic flatulence around the 47-minute mark. It's absolutely hilarious.
You're listening to the sweet sounds of the After Movie Diner with your host, Jon Cross.
That's quite right, Spike. I am Jon Cross. And hello and welcome to the After Movie Diner. We'll get to all the movie talk in a moment. But first, we have a voicemail. Well, an MP3, but it's kind of like a voicemail. They emailed it to me from the wonderful, charming, and excellent Matthew Beckett. Now, Matt Beckett, people who have been listening to the show for, well, since the beginning, will remember, is a gentleman who sort of once every few months kind of sends us an audio clip, and it's kind of wonderful. And I sort of expect to stop hearing from him, and then all of a sudden, I hear from him again, and it's even more wonderful. And it's just lovely to know that there's been a listener out there who I don't really know, apart from obviously his wonderful communiques with the show, who, you know, keeps listening and occasionally goes, you know what, I think I'll send that John fellow another one of my audio clips. And I tell you what, every time he does, it's a delight. And every time he does, I wish it was a weekly feature. However, here it is. It's the Matt Beckett audio bit, and I love it. I hope you love it too. And it talks all about an episode that I did with Marcus not long ago at all. The Tapeheads episode.
Hello, John. Matt Beckett here. Just calling in to offer my continued thanks for the After Movie Diner podcast, a show that manages to be forever eclectic, eccentric and engaging. And your recent trip back to the 1980s was a particular highlight. I was glad to hear that Marcus Pym's warm and wonderful tales, excavating the early work of Matt Dillon and Martin Donovan, brought the most natural grin to both actors' faces, because they certainly did to mine. And your ruminations upon the movies you'd discuss with Tim Robbins, or the 80s pictures that people would remember Tom Hanks for, definitely struck a chord with me. You also hit the target when you implied that it's most rewarding to go one level down from the well-regarded A pictures. The movie that's held its place for 30 years as my own favourite from Tom Hanks's back catalogue is 1986's Nothing in Common. In this picture, Hanks plays David Basner, who makes a profitable living from the kind of impertinence that made many of his earlier incarnations so memorable. As an advertising executive on the rise, he is all their audacity taken to its logical conclusion. But Basner experiences a dramatic shift in his life, as new circumstances mean he has to become the responsible parent to his own parents. The man who lives by the maxim, "It is economically unsound to grow up," now becomes, in essence, the more complex elder brother of Hanks's own character in Big. There's also a wonderfully evoked atmosphere of 80s time and place, with location shooting in a chilly and crisp Chicago. To top it all, there's a supremely brave final performance from Jackie Gleason. As Max Basner, David's father, he's not afraid to be unlikable. And nor is the film itself afraid to be abrasive or to be about an unabashedly mature subject. It hits quite a few raw nerves and breaks the bounds of what some might see as a bubblegum genre. Even as a youngish viewer, much more used to the outrageous action or screwball pratfalls of an 80s video shelf, Hanks's spirit was all it took to captivate me for the duration of the drama. Now, these days it's a lot less difficult to find, but back in the day, amongst a rogues gallery of volunteers, the money pit, and mazes and monsters, Nothing in Common was almost as deep in terms of digging a level down as 1986's Every Time We Say Goodbye. I was also fascinated to follow your discussion about Alex Cox and hear of your fondness for Moviedrome. I still have the two booklets that the BBC produced to accompany the first six series of Cox's tenure on the show, and I particularly treasure his introduction to The Good, the Bad and the Ugly, where he evoked the spirit of an epic desert vista half a globe away simply by sitting quietly, polishing one of his cowboy boots. And if you're ever looking for a great example of what the estimable Mr. Pin described as a filmmaker with an opinion who really dissects, then look no further than Cox's book, 10,000 Ways to Die, A Director's Take on the Spaghetti Western. You were both right that Cox has had a career of twists and turns, including 1989's unproduced script for Doctor Strange, or 2009's jarringly named Repo Chick. But it is satisfying to note that Roger Corman, so regularly referenced on Moviedrome, helped in the production of Cox's 2007 Searchers 2.0. So many thanks again, John, for taking the time to take us all back in time.
See what I mean? Who could ask for more than that? I mean, if that isn't one of the most eloquent and wonderful and filmic knowledgeable type chaps you would want listening to a movie podcast, then I don't know who Ballywell is. The wonderful Matt Beckett there raises many points about Alex Cox. I do think I need to get off my flabby behind and watch some of his later films. Obviously, I'm aware of the old Sid and Nancy and Repo Man, but I need to go watch some other stuff. So maybe I will. Maybe my conversation with Marcus and now Matt Beckett's message has pushed me to do so. Who knows? Maybe we do an Alex Cox series on the diner. Who knows? Who knows what'll happen? This show just bounces all over the shop. But this week, well, you know what this week means, don't you? Well, obviously, because you've read the description probably on the podcast app that you're using. But anyway, it's an exciting week. It's an inaugural week of this year's very special James Spader-related month. But I'll let us talk about it when we cut over to the diner. But don't forget, if you want to send us in an MP3 like that, you can email it to me at aftermoviediner@gmail.com or hello@aftermoviediner.com. You can call us, leave a voicemail at 347-669-0053 or at speakpipe.com/aftermoviediner. And you can find us at all the usual social media places, anywhere where After Movie Diner is typed in and looked up. And equally, there is a contact page on the website where all this stuff is written out. So please do that. We do love having feedback from the fans, and especially during this upcoming month when I know you all get involved with your Spader-related comments, please do send us something in. Anyway, won't let you wait any longer. Let us dive right in and go to the Square Diner down, 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 down in Tribeca, Manhattan.
Can I get the NYC Classic and a cup of Earl Grey tea?
Okay.
Thank you.
And I'm happy with water, but can I just get two eggs with ham and fries, please?
How do you like the eggs?
Over easy.
Waiter?
Sure.
Perfect. Thanks very much.
Ham, right?
Ham, yeah. Ham, two eggs and fries. Thank you. All right. Hello and welcome to the After Movie Diner. And we are exorbitantly happy and somewhat moist around the brow.
Well, that's your allergies.
That's my allergies. It is my allergies. They have been playing up and kicking one's posterior of late. We are here in the Square Diner, which I can't help but notice is more triangular, down in Tribeca in New York. And our returning champion, a regular co-host and a good old friend of mine, Mr. Jim Wallace, is back with us after a slight absence due to a Floridian holiday.
Thank you very much.
Meaning a holiday in Florida, not a holiday dunked in fluoride.
No, I was not dunked in fluoride at any point.
No.
Would that be nice?
No, because, maybe, because doesn't it make you sleepy and docile?
I think maybe.
Isn't like that the whole point of the conspiracy theory that says they put it in our water to make us all, I don't know, consume more Chelsea Handler?
Well, that particular part of the plan has not worked.
And wear more baseball caps or whatever.
I don't wear baseball caps or watch Chelsea Handler. Right. But I do feel more pliant when it comes to like the government's wants. Do you know what I mean?
Do you?
Yeah, I think so.
Really?
As time goes by, I feel more like, all right, push me around. You know?
I ain't going to fight back, Governor.
Yeah,
I'm too old and feeble.
And the eggs over easy, right?
Thank you.
Oh, can I get some eggs over easy? Yes, please. Thank
can
you.
I get milk?
Thank you.
Yeah, so whatever. You went down to Florida, you had a holiday, and while you were
the
gone...
The end.
While you were gone, I spoke to a couple of lovely filmmakers.
Oh, yeah, I saw that. That's nice.
That was
productive.
Wonderful. No, it was. It was excellent. I can't urge people enough to check out both Hunting Grounds, which is already out on VOD, DVD, and Blu-ray on Amazon. Click through the link on the website, please. And then tomorrow, the day we're recording this, but Friday the 5th of May, you will have already been gone by the time you hear this, but the wonderful Herschel Gordon Lewis's Blood Mania became available on Prime.
Thank you very much.
Amazon Prime. So,
oh, cool.
A little amendment to this point. Actually, Herschel Gordon Lewis's Blood Mania did not become available on the 5th of May due to technical issues, but should, by the time you are listening to this podcast, be available on Amazon Prime. Don't forget to click through the links and Amazon banner on the aftermoviediner.com to support us at no extra cost yourself. Marvelous.
You can not only support wonderful filmmakers by watching their wonderful films, but you can support the diner a little bit as well and click through the banner on the website. So it's all very exciting. So we had that.
It is. These are exciting times to be you.
These are exciting times to be me. But what we thought we'd do this week is re-energize something we know that was particularly exciting and positive and popular last year, and that is Sleazy Spader Springtime.
Oh, it's Sleazy Spader Springtime. Welcome to the show. Oh, it's a Sleazy Spader Springtime. I want you all to know that if you please, there's James Spader Sleazing, it's got nowhere else to go. So loosen all your blouses, give your nose a damn good blow, 'cause now we're coming clean, oh yeah. It's 2017, Sleazy Spader Springtime.
Yes, I'm very much looking forward to covering more of the spades.
More of the spades, more of the sleazy spades. So what we did was we both kind of watched the film separately and then decided to pick a diner in Manhattan that we'd never been to before, walk to said diner, and record said podcast. So I looked up today some diners that I haven't been to, two which popped up was the Pearl Street Diner, which we must go to at some point, which is right down in near Wall Street, down in the financial, the belly of the beast. And then the other one was the Square Diner, which was a bit closer in Tribeca, still a good 48-minute walk away, but very pleasant, very affable.
Which bit?
The walk? The scenery,
The walk was quite affable right up into the part where your bladder tried to kill you.
Yeah, my bladder did try and kill me.
And then there was that subtle increase where we went from walking leisurely to walking quite a bit faster than leisurely.
Yeah, because I needed to pee.
While I, like, followed around in the wake of a man, A, desperate to find someone to take a piss.
Yeah.
And B, following, like, his phone's map instructions for how to get to the diner. Yeah. And the two things trying to take place at once in a brain that was entirely consumed by its bladder screaming.
Yeah.
It led to a few wrong turns and a few figure eights. And I was fine. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
I wouldn't describe that part of the journey as affable.
No, it's true. I had what I
lovably liked. Desperate.
I think I had what I would probably refer to as a John Wallace bladder moment.
Yeah, like a John Wallace bladder crisis.
There were many times your brother and my good friend John Wallace, growing up, there would be many times where plans would be derailed by quite some time and also by quite some detours often to find a McDonald's that he could take a piss in.
Every time we went out, at some point it would be scuppered by John needing to go for a piss.
Yeah, John's bladder upended so many. We were late for movies and late for gigs and late for trains.
There are things you forget when you don't hang out with John.
On a regular
basis. Just with people, I guess.
I wonder if his bladder is still like that, whether he just sits at home and urinates into a cup. or whether he's stolen some of
his
babies.
The urinary habits of the not rich or famous.
of the largely lazy.
Yeah, of the lazy.
Growing heavily older.
Yeah.
Shaggy, the old and lazy men.
Yeah.
Yes, it's a real pleasure to have you back, so it really is.
Thank you very much.
Looking forward with bright eyes and gusto to the next 4 weeks.
Yes.
Where we do another four sleazy Spader films. We last year started around this time in April. It's now this time in May. I think it's fine. I still have allergies, which means it's still technically spring.
Yeah, I think if we get it done in May, I think that qualifies as spring. But I think we have to...
Well, we'll probably one in June. We'll probably have, if we do fall, it'll be the first week in June. It'll be the last
one. We could just call it a sleazy spade a summer.
No.
A summer
don't change.
Sleaze.
Don't right, change your right. winning formula.
Okay.
Just because you had to...
And by winning, you mean
Florida.
Not losing.
Yeah.
Okay.
By
We're not
winning,
actively losing money by doing it.
By winning, I mean some people listened. In fact, that's not true. I listened to two of the old episodes today, and by the second episode of Sleazy Spader Springtime, we actually had multiple questions, feedbacks, and all sorts
that's
of great
true.
Stuff.
Yeah, that's true. We stirred a beast.
We did.
Stirred a beast
and
of
so,
desire for Spader
and so we are,
within the belly.
We are asking again
yes, we are.
That people reach out. And there are multiple places where you can reach out. You can reach out via email at hello@aftermoviediner.com or just aftermoviediner@gmail.com. Either one is fine. There is a contact form on the website you can fill out. There are comment sections on the website. So in other words, if you're listening to this episode, you're like, oh, I have a question. You can put it right there. You don't even have to go off the page. It's right there. There's a comment section. You can hit us up on Facebook at facebook.com/aftermoviediner or in the After Movie Diner Dr. Action Facebook group. You can hit us up on Twitter, all sorts of places. You can even call us at 347-669-0053.
Or you could take the more popular route, which is you think of a question to ask us and then you get distracted by a bee and never get around to it.
Yeah, or you
which
fall
is by far and away
what normally
the
happens.
Most popular form of communication with the diner, which is
bee distracted.
Think about it briefly before being distracted by something else.
Except there are very few bees anymore. So
that's
I would
true.
Probably say distracted by I don't know, a lame...
it's Sleazy Spader Springtime, after all.
Distracted by glazed thighs.
Yeah.
On a summer's day.
Yes.
So, yeah, maybe that's what you do. I was going to go for, like, some sad, orphan, lame dog that maybe you get distracted by and you feel like nursing back to health. But with
write the question on its side and post the lame dog to New York.
Because we found out that if you can't sell a rat with the words "I love New York" scrawled haphazardly into the side of it, then you aren't anybody in this world.
That's true. That's true. Yeah.
At Hipster Goofball Central.
The Hipster Goofball Central, yeah.
So, Jim, I'm going to give you the unpleasant task of telling
everyone...
Well,
I know. I would like to ask a question.
Yeah,
okay. I think I'm entitled to ask this question.
Yeah.
And the question is, listeners, that when we embarked upon a second year of Sleazy Spader Springtime, which I was very enthusiastic about, Jon Cross informed me that he'd already seen very recently a James Spader film, and he said, we should start with that one.
Yeah,
it's called White Palace. Yeah. And my question is...
It's called White Palace for people who didn't...
Why?
Right.
Why?
Why?
Why, having seen this film, did you go, somebody else needs to watch this.
Right, because...
Because we could definitely talk entertainingly about this film for an hour.
Yeah.
And there is literally maybe one or possibly two moments of, like, passing slings. And not that it wasn't good, I'm just...
No, it's an awful film.
Why?
Right, okay. Because, honestly,
yes.
if I'm 100% honest,
yes.
I could see Springtime slipping away from us.
Right.
I knew that I was very, very busy.
Right.
And that all the other Spader films... more or less, apart from a couple that are on Amazon, would require you to come round to mine and watch a movie and do all
that.
I've got
Amazon.
Blah, blah, blah,
I can
blah,
watch
blah.
Amazon.
No, I said apart from a couple on Amazon, all the rest, like the good ones that I want to do, like New Kids and some others, I own, and you would have to come round and...
Which is fine.
So, having just seen one and not wanting to wait any longer, I just went, let's do it, because I think there is something to talk about with this movie, because my question in return to you is, because I completely agree with you, it's awful, my question in response to you is, why on earth do you think this movie, like, what is this movie about? This movie isn't about anything.
Well, okay, so...
On the surface, like, the surface plot is... younger boy falls in love with older woman from two different class structures. One's very working class and one's very kind of upper middle, yuppie, basically. And he struggles with that a bit.
Well, my suspicion is...
Like, why was this made? Why did
It was based on a book.
Yeah, but what was the book about?
Well, I can only assume a couple of things, right? First of all, I'm guessing that the lead male character in the book was a bit of a nebbish Jewish fellow.
Right.
And because this is Hollywood, they went, yeah, we'll cast James Spader in the role of nebbish Jew. Because
it's the, like, most Caucasian person.
Because after about half an hour, because I watched it with Teresa, and she went, she referred to him as like a Jewish character. I went, is he supposed to be Jewish? Yes. But look at his mum and all of his friends. And then after that, he describes himself as Jewish. But and I'm guessing that the waitress was not a glamorous 40-something movie star.
Thank you, sir. Oh, that looks lovely.
Oh, my word. Thank you. That looks fantastic. This is going to kill me, but it's...
Enjoy.
Thank you so much. What did you order again?
I ordered the New York special, which is...
apparently, bacon?
Homemade corned beef.
Wow.
And sauerkraut covered in melted Swiss cheese on toasted rye bread.
My God, that looks amazing.
You should dig in, have some.
I might do that. So, yeah, no, I understand.
So, in other words, if it's a book about a nebbish Jewish guy who's lost his wife...
Right.
...who's surrounded by friends and family who are constantly telling him what to do,
right,
what to
be... Because his best friend of this is Jason Alexander.
...in the worst wig I've ever seen in my life.
Right. Because the man never had hair. He literally looks like that episode of Seinfeld where he puts on a wig and thinks he should keep it, and everyone tells him he looks like a dark paper. Right.
And then an over-the-hill waitress... with fantasies of being like Marilyn Monroe.
Right.
Those two characters, and presumably he's probably not exactly good looking, but I would guess in the book looks kind of boyish. Because really it's about, you know, she lost her kid and he's got, a domineering mother that he kind of hates.
Right.
And there's this powerful, clearly, I would guess, in the book, powerful attraction to people where they're filling up these giant holes in their lives with sex instead of love.
Right.
And for some reason, even though they're totally mismatched and both of their worlds, you know, keep trying to expel the other one from them,
right,
they can't stop this relationship.
Right.
And it becomes all-consuming. Now, I'm guessing if that was written in an interesting way, you know, in a compelling way, that could be an interesting book, because it would be about things that you didn't realise that you needed, you know,
I guess you could
taken
also,
over your life.
Yeah, you could write it also in a bit of a sort of Bukowski, Barfly, Beatnik kind of way,
right,
where it's about, like, the haphazard lives of, you know, broken people.
Right.
And yeah, so I guess, like, and that makes it sound kind of interesting.
Right, but
the film,
classic,
on the other hand...
Yeah, see, the classic example of Hollywood, right? Because on the one... The thing... There's one thing that's wrong with this film and one thing that's right with this film. And
okay.
It's the same thing. And the one thing that's wrong with this film is that you totally ruin the underlying thing that you're going for by casting two extremely good-looking... Hollywood stars,
right,
in the lead, who, while Susan Sarandon is obviously a bit older than James Spader, it's not, you know, it doesn't look like 16 years. It doesn't look like a 43-year-old woman going out with a 27-year-old. They look like she's in her, you know, late 30s and he's in his own. It just, they're Hollywood stars. They always look like a little bit ageless.
Right.
You know, and they don't look anything like their characters. She's supposed to be someone who wants to be a Hollywood starlet. And presumably, it would be a bit pathetic in the book. But she's Susan Sarandon and she is a Hollywood star and can't be anything else. And James Spader's supposed to be like boyish and immature, but he's like James Spader, and like he looks like, maybe his face is young, but he looks like he has the, you know, he's got the soul of a long, you know, long forgotten demon from, you know, the underworld. The point being, that's what's wrong with it. But what's right with it is, despite the fact that nothing happens and it's cliched nonsense, and the dialogue and the writing is absurd and appalling.
Yeah.
It is somehow quite compelling because of how good Susan Sarandon and James Spader are at acting.
Right.
And that's it.
But I think you're missing out one major point about this film.
Okay, got them.
The sandwich.
The sandwich is...
The sandwich.
The sandwich
whose
is weird.
Idea...
I don't know.
Whose idea was the... And I can only assume it was Spader's. And I think the reason why, this is another reason, why you can't do a Spader retrospective without including this.
Okay.
Is because the sandwich, the picking up of a stale, moldy sandwich,
right,
off the floor of this rickety old shack that, right, she lives in, the waitress, right, lives in, during a ridiculous sex scene between these two people. Sniffing it in the midst of rapture and then waving it about as if it was like a silk handkerchief and you were Oscar bloody Wilde. That has to be the most Spadery move,
yeah,
I've ever seen.
No, I'd have to say there's a more Spadery move in this movie.
Well, the V-neck,
right,
without the shirt.
No, that was a very Spader touch.
Right.
No, my moment of absolute spaderness.
I don't know anything beats sniffing a mouldy sandwich mid coitus, but all right, go ahead.
I think it's standing over the grave of his dead wife, flashbacking to the orgasm and speaking silently to himself and making crazy crazy shapes with his mouth while he's remembering what the orgasm was like while he's looking down at the grave of his dead wife. That was extremely sleazy.
If he'd remembered...
The sandwich was weird, but remembering an orgasm while looking at your dead wife
If he'd remembered the sandwich,
but maybe that was a part of it. We never got to see something. We never
but
got to
I,
see
I
what
feel
he
like,
was remembering.
I feel like the sandwich is the crux to this movie. I feel like within the sandwich is contained all we need to know about White Palace.
But the problem right there with the sandwich, by the way, this is unbelievable. I mean, you have to have some. The problem with the sandwich is it's a lot like the rest of the movie. It's weird. It doesn't really make any sense.
Right.
I don't even feel like Spader believes in it.
Oh,
like,
no.
In the move, someone else told him to do that.
No, no, no.
He doesn't
it
believe it.
It was totally his idea.
You think?
And I think the director left it in because I think Spader probably went, you realise I did that as a joke, but let's do another take. And the director went, no, 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 it's perfect. It says all we need to say about the disconnect between these two people. And
right.
Blah, blah, blah. Like, I think Spader did it as a joke. And the pretentious director believes in it.
Yeah, I think that's what it comes down to. I can go along with that. I just, you know.
So first of all, should people watch this movie before we get deep into the sandwich?
No.
Should people watch it?
No.
What about people interested in early 90s Sarandon boobs?
No.
No?
Hold on. There's got to be better Sarandon boobs.
Not even the boobs can save it, then?
Well, the boobs are hardly in it. There's got to be better surrounding boobs, right? There has to be.
But don't you think... Okay, so you were saying earlier that, like, they're both Hollywood starlets. That's true, but, like...
So, okay, think about this, right? Think about the scene where Spader takes Sarandon to his family Thanksgiving, right?
Right.
And that's supposed to be, like, imagine it in the book. The boyish, immature guy...
Yeah.
Who they all, you know... Presumably, to a certain extent, mother, because his mother's clearly a bit useless. They don't really touch on that in the movie too much, but that's clearly what it is. She's
right.
Hopeless. So he's mothered by everybody else, like by this entire community. And he had this perfect wife, you know, that died in a tragic accident, and they're trying to get him, you know, back on his feet, and blah,
right.
blah, blah. And they were, oh, he's got this mysterious woman. And he turns up at this Thanksgiving with this, I can only assume... to be like grease-stained, overweight, bleach-blonde, middle-aged waitress.
In the book,
right? In the book.
Right.
Which would be like funny and tragic and sad, but also kind of... There would be so many things going on in that one scene with this woman who's clearly out of place. But Sarandon walks in, like... And she's supposed to be like, oh, I'm all dowdy. But she's like Susan Sarandon, being incredibly glamorous, wearing glamorous things, alongside other people who are roughly the same age and look about
the same.
See, I don't
know. I actually thought one of the things that the movie did quite well was take someone like Susan Sarandon, who you're right, could totally be glam, and when in that scene you're talking about, I felt the awkwardness of her being there because she was dressed glam as if she was dressing glam from Target. Do you know what I mean? Like, she played that, and that's not to knock anyone who shops at Target, I shop at it, but I'm just saying, no. In the movie, she was glam in the way that, like, Barbara Windsor in the Queen Vic glams it up. You know what I mean? It's not like, it's not like proper glam or believable glam or wealthy glam. It was an approximation, a cheap approximation of what glam is.
I
thought she actually did that, considering she's Susan Sarandon.
No,
I actually thought she did that very well.
She was great. I'm just saying, if you imagine the scene the way it was written in the book, where that contrast between her and the whole world
right.
would be enormous. And the fact that he can't stop seeing her and she can't stop seeing him, and these two people are trying to make it work in this ridiculous relationship work, in this ridiculous world, would be like quite a powerful moment, but it's lost in the movie because she's very convincing at playing a character, but you don't get that kind of gut reaction of I didn't feel embarrassed for her at any point. I didn't feel embarrassed for them. There wasn't enough of a clash between her
right.
and his world, and that should have been like a whole thing. And it's just because she's too bloody glamorous. It's like when Michelle Pfeiffer tries to play the dowdy waitress in Frankie and John.
Right.
It's like Al Pacino can get away with playing a deadbeat ex-con chef. That I buy.
Right.
But Michelle Pfeiffer is unattractive waitress that nobody's interested in is ridiculous.
True. You're right. You are right.
And it's like that with Sarandon. It's not her fault. And she's great. And the bits where it's just him and her. But he's not being sleazy. I can't decide. Okay, let me ask you a question. Did he play a good drunk or a bad drunk? I can't figure it out.
He played a good drunk.
It was pretty good,
I think
good,
he
right?
played a really good drunk. You really felt him trying to compose himself. Yeah. You really did. Like, you... When he was at her place and wanting to leave, you could feel that thing that would go through his mind where he would be like, shit, whatever I do, I have to get a bus. I have to get a cab. I have to... like, you could really feel, like, the journey home you would have to take.
Yeah.
And that resolve of just, like, oh, I guess I'm sleeping on this couch. I thought that what the movie focuses on, kind of interestingly, but also to its detriment, is basically the concept of, like, the judgments of others. You know what I mean? Like, the judgments of all the different classes and the judgments of all the different... Even politics at one point, right? Like when Sarandon brings up politics at the dinner table, right?
Yeah, well, she's just calling out the, you know, gobshite relative. But at least in the context of the Thanksgiving dinner, you're supposed to get like a thrill of like the, like that's the, you know, that would be supposed to be like quite a thrilling scene where the outsider comes in and puts the mouthy, you know, racist. Well, not racist, but like the mouthy uncle in their place.
Which is ignorant, right?
Muddy run. And that's supposed to be like, you know, he's talking about helping the working class, and here she is, real working class. But again, it gets undermined by the fact that it's Susan Sarandon doing her big, you know, doing her big speech, as opposed to this dowdy woman.
I know,
who's
right,
scared.
Right, right.
It's just like all of that, all of the power, I think, the original story in the book is totally taken. And you can see when they told the guy that wrote this book that they were casting Susan Sarandon and James Spader, he probably didn't stop punching himself in the face. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
Like the utter despair you must feel when you go, they've got the book. And he's like, I can see him sitting down with his agent going, they're going to be true to it. They've told me they're not going to change it. They're going to keep the ending. Don't worry about it. They're going to cast, you know, big stars, but the right people. And then nothing.
I mean, in terms of like which Hollywood people to cast at that time,
I can't believe there's a shortage of talented, nebbish Jewish guys.
I suppose like a young Stiller would have been better than
Stiller or
Spader. Was Stiller around at this point?
No.
When is this movie?
1990.
Okay.
Stiller would have worked, I think. Somebody just very boyish. I think they went with Spader because they went with boyish.
Right. The trouble is, I
which
also
is probably
think,
more
is
important than the Jewish thing.
Is that
it's
Spader
more...
brings with him, and because of the opening scenes as well.
But you have to try this fucking.
I will.
This corn, no, this corned beef is like to die for. I've never eaten beef as good as this. It's like, you know how like when you get like a really good bit of like bacon fat with bacon, and it's like it's got like that kind of flavour. It's unbelievable.
This bit here.
Yeah.
I know what they're going for because they're trying to do the whole entitled thing, but I think almost Spader, having played predominantly through the 80s a lot of like yuppie doucheholes, I think comes too much with that baggage of being like a yuppie arsehole. Like it kind of, I found it very, very, very difficult to like him and or root for him.
Yeah. Well, because he's
at the beginning of the movie.
Spader is a terrific actor. But there's like a black hole in the centre of his being.
Right.
That is, which is, you know.
And no sandwich, no matter where he finds it, is going to fill.
Is going to fill that hole.
Right.
If he's playing a certain kind of character, that black hole is like a compelling absence. Like, what's there? Who is he? What is he after? What does he want?
Right.
But in this movie, it's like, you're right, it leaves him to be a bit, he's quite alienating, and he's presumably your connection.
So what's the mad sister all about?
I know, that was like a weird... Well, she was, okay, narratively speaking...
I mean, she just reveals what happened to
exactly,
her son.
Well, that's all she really is. She's, you know, she's that... She's a delivery system for that revelation. But all of the, like, psychic bollocks... It's like, it's very strange, and... I can only assume it's a bigger deal in the book. That maybe I don't know how it could ever play out, but then maybe she's a bit more of a, I mean, I, what I can see,
because what happens in the movie, we should just preface this,
oh yeah,
We're not really explaining the film at all, but...
No, we're not.
Whatever.
Shall I do a quick plot rundown?
Yeah, do a quick plot thing.
All right, quick plot rundown.
If nothing else, it'll kill some more minutes.
James Spader... Oh, my favourite bit of the movie, actually, is... right at the beginning. So, sorry, let me do the plot. Sorry. So James Spader.
It was already derailed before he even started.
I know. So James Spader, young ad exec, as Teresa pointed out, from the days when being an ad exec and a copywriter in movies was like, what a cool, interesting job that must be, as opposed to like, what a soul-deadening experience. Anyway, James Spader, 27-year-old ad exec with a recently dead wife. Working for Kathy Bates, doing a series of her
motherly, supportive, you're my boy roles, which she seemed to have done a lot.
This goes nowhere. There's a bit in the movie like, you've got this important account, don't fuck it up. You go, I wonder if he'll fuck it up. It's never mentioned again.
No.
Anyway. James Spader, 27-year-old addict, Zach, recently dead wife, has shut himself off from the world emotionally. But because he's part of a... small Jewish community in St. Louis. Well, no, because his mum's part of it as well, so...
No, but all those guys at the beginning, isn't that like a fraternity? Or is he's getting engaged, right?
Yeah, I think it's just like... I think it's just like a small community in St. Louis of these Jewish families. And they're nagging him, He needs to get out there, And one night, on the bachelor party... he bumps into the waitress that he had an argument with earlier that night
from the aforementioned white palace, which I really don't think works either as a title or metaphor or anything for the movie.
It might work better in the book, I suppose.
Saying the book, because neither of us have read it. You are imbuing this book with mythic proportions, and it might simply
but
not
But somebody
have.
Paid millions of dollars to like for the rights to the books. It must have been.
Did they?
Yeah, that's what you do when you buy the rights.
How do you know they didn't buy it for like 50 cents over coffee?
I just... You don't attach like scenes rather than James Spader in the 90s. To a movie of a book, unless you've spent money on the book, you know what I mean? Because everybody,
I don't know. This wasn't like prime. This like Sarandon hadn't like hooked up with Robbins and started doing all her most successful stuff yet.
Okay.
I don't know. When did
still like, of all the books that are published in New York or in America? I'm sure there were many. Why this one?
Probably because, like I say...
No, stop derailing my prop deck.
All right, sorry, yeah. It's just you're imbuing the book with a whole bunch of significance that we just don't know it has.
No, I'm not saying the book has significance. I'm trying to justify the inexplicable things that happen in the movie.
All right.
And if there's, like, a book that people liked enough to, like, go, let's make this into a movie, then it's possible that those things lived in that place.
Right.
Like, it is called White Palace.
Right.
And many we could sit here and talk about what's good about the movie.
Speculation.
We could sit here and talk about what's good about the movie, but that wouldn't take very fucking long, would it? So you may as well indulge my baseless speculation, because obviously it's going to be a very, very short fucking podcast.
I had the sandwich and that was it.
Do you want me to tell the bleeding plot?
Yes, tell the bleeding plot.
James Spader.
Yeah.
27-year-old Alex.
Yeah.
Recently dead wife. Shut off emotionally from the world. Pissed one night, bumps into a waitress, and they begin a passionate affair that neither of them really understands. And James Spader, I'm never going to get this bloody synopsis done, am I?
It's all right. I'll add lots of comedy jingles. No. Listen, put it this way, Sleazy Spader Springtime can only go up. It can only go forward. It can only get better. Keep expectations low, Chief, and then...
We
really
still
hidden.
Haven't found the elusive Sleazy Spader movie that's actually, you know, just good.
Well, no, but we didn't go out of our way to watch any. We went out of our way to watch, like, what the hell is this?
No, but you and John, when you did your Woods and Weller...
Right, but that's because Woods and Weller made some corking movies back in the day.
Yeah, but when you watched them, you're like, I've never heard of this, I've never done anything about it, and it's brilliant.
Right.
That has not happened to us yet.
Well, that's not true. Most of the movies that we did with Woods and Weller, I had heard of.
The Rats one?
Yeah, I'd heard of that.
Oh, okay. Yeah, but you... Okay, but you're different. You're weird.
I am different. I am weird.
The After Movie Diner with Jon Cross will return right after this.
News on the march!
The year 2014. Two best friends set out on a journey to produce the best content related to all things film. In 2015, they founded a podcast to share their passions with the world. From rants, lisps, and beer, to trailers, challenges, and premieres, Nick and Justin have you covered. Find the Epic Film Guys podcast at epicfilmguys.podbean.com and follow the show on Twitter. And we'll see you at the movies.
The Via VHS podcast is changing lives. Here's some testimonials. Bill from Tallahassee, Florida says, I was able to quit my job and get a Ferrari, just like Magnum P.I. Sue from San Diego, California says, wow, it really helped with my crippling depression. Thanks, Via VHS. And Tom from Charlotte, North Carolina says, it cured my genital warts. Wow. Listen to the Via VHS podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and Google Play.
You're listening to the sweet sounds of the After Movie Diner. Support us at patreon.com/AfterMovieDiner. Or I'll punch you in the teats. Rate and review us on iTunes, Earthling.
Right, I'm going to do the bloody synopsis now. Go
once
ahead. And for all, and that'll be
speculation.
All right. Right, off we go. James Spader. Right. 27-year-old addict, Zach. Recently dead wife.
Yep.
Meets waitress while pissed one night. They begin a passionate affair that neither of them understands, that will neither of them really thinks, well, she hopes it's going somewhere.
Well, she understands it better than he does.
Yeah, that's true. He keeps lying about her to his friends and his family until eventually he gets kind of trapped into taking her to Thanksgiving, which is all a big disaster because she feels out of place. And then she leaves town, and then one day, months later, while he's talking to a dull person, he decides he loves her after all and chases her to New York, where New York proves itself to be apparently the opposite of St. Louis, because in New York people will break into applause when
you try and shaft your woman on
when you kiss the older woman rather than run screaming. I don't know. Anyway, yeah, so that's the plot. That's what happened in the movie.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Is that fair?
Fair enough.
And, you know, watching it, it was not an unenjoyable experience because they're both such incredibly talented people. But all the way through, I was thinking, right, but, like, this isn't really telling me anything, or there's no big funny moments, even though it wants there to be like big moments. It wants there to be like big movie moments, but it doesn't hit anything it's aiming for, except that if you put James Spader and Susan Sarandon in a room together and have those characters that they're playing in an interesting situation, that they will make that watchable.
Right.
But beyond that, it doesn't really have anything going for it, as far as I'm concerned.
No. But I think that the key... If we're going to go key Spader moments...
All right.
Sandwich.
Yeah.
Gotta be.
Yeah.
Playing drunk.
Yeah.
V-neck sweater without shirt or T-shirt underneath.
The bit when he comes back in... from taking a psychic sister to a car, and he's wearing an overcoat, and because he's wearing the V-neck sweater, when he takes the overcoat off, there's a brief moment you think, is he going to be nude underneath the jacket, which is like classic Spader.
Yeah.
I mean, am I going to nude bomb them?
Am I going to nude bomb them? Is that a thing?
And the fact that he wears a vest but no underpants. Yeah.
That was really weird. I cut to the shot of him taking his shirt off. He's got a vest on but no underpants. When did his trousers and underpants go?
Well, he just dropped them because isn't that when he runs back in? He's late for work, but he runs back in to have one more time with her.
Yeah. All I can remember is he's only wearing a vest and no undies, and do I really have to look at Spader's arse again? I've seen Spader's arse
more
times than I care to remember.
We are doing a Sleazy Spader Springtime. You are going to be forced categorically to look at that man's
buttocks. Does Susan Sarandon do the worst on-screen orgasm ever?
Yes.
I feel like she might.
Yeah.
She sounded like I think what she sounded like.
Okay, so let me ask you this. This is quite controversial.
Oh, okay.
And I think we're only saved this hypothesis by the fact that I think it's almost impossible to do this to Spader, as I imagine he's always fully prepared.
Right.
But isn't it
by
like,
prepared you mean erect?
Yes. Isn't it like technically sort of like not rapey but like mouth rapey to begin with? The whole he's drunk, passed out. She takes it upon herself to mouth rape him.
Yeah.
Now, she does then ask, like, more. And he's like, yes, all right. So, like, there's your consent. But it was a little. Or are we just meant to assume that men at that time, like, men, it's a fair game for men because they always want it.
I think you're probably getting into a thing where it is a bit different for men and for women.
I think it's probably a bit different for James Spader. I imagine James Spader's never turned it down in his life. I imagine a small pot-bellied Puerto Rican.
Yeah, he might even have fallen asleep on set. Do you know what I mean? And like Sarandon couldn't resist and they just kept the cameras rolling.
Yeah, or like I say, like I imagine that the person running the craft service table or the pot-bellied Puerto Rican gentleman
was
who was cleaning up.
It was a lot less erotic than I thought it was going
to
be.
Well, this was the other thing, is that in order to...
Because the front cover is like, Spader and Sarandon are going to get erotic in this one.
Yeah.
And it was not erotic.
Well, there are two scenes, aren't there? There is the scene where he's passed out and she wakes him up and then they have sex and he wafts a sandwich erotically in front of his nose, which...
And the Sarandon orgasm.
Which I have to say has to be seen to be believed, him wafting a sandwich. It really is quite...
He does waft it in a very fey way.
Yeah, no, completely.
It's very like...
It's totally affectation centric.
Foppish.
Foppish,
it's
definitely.
It's a foppish wafting of a sandwich during the sex act.
It's a fop waft.
Which is possibly the only time it's ever been done.
A foppy waft. A fop waft. Fop waft.
Right, pop waft. I was confused and I stopped in my tracks.
I'm looking for the tagline to this episode. Sleazy Spader Springtime, White Palace, Fop Waft.
Fop Waft, yeah.
Or Sandwich Fop Waft. So, sorry, Spader moments. Sandwich, Phoenix sweater.
Recalling the orgasm I'm looking at is dead wide's grave, but with like a kind of... There's this... The reason that it's my like sleazy Spader moment is there's a real sleaze in the eyes.
Yeah.
There's a sleaziness around the eyes while he's thinking about the orgasm.
He wears a tuxedo for the first like 8 minutes of the movie. That's pretty sleazy. Because no one wears a tuxedo quite like Spader. He does wear it in a sort of like, this cummerbund is coming undone, whether you like it or not, type
way. That's the thing, like, at the beginning we're supposed to think of him as like a neat, fussy, like cold fish.
Right.
But when he's going around like straightening things in his apartment and putting on his immaculate suit, I just thought, serial killer.
right, yeah.
Not, when Spader's being neat, it's like, you know, look out, local prostitutes.
Right. Now, he's going to be adding to his collection of stiletto shoes.
Yeah. My favourite bit at the beginning of like the, there were like bits that were, whoever wrote the script does need shooting, because all, like the bits at the beginning of the movie, they were like, well, we better like, you know, establish our characters in a like a convincingly cinematic way. Like the bit with the, where they do like the slideshow of the bachelor party, go, oh, and here's a slide of me when I was young, and here's a slide of my wife to be, and then third slide up is picture of Spader's dead wife as a kid.
Right.
And there's like, you know, stunned silence, And Spader's like looking at it, you know, all mesmerised. And I remember thinking, so what exactly was that? Have you got the dead wife in the... don't forget to put the dead wife in the slideshow.
Make sure that if we're doing...
For God's sake, make sure the dead wife is in there.
Because I really don't think there's anything...
What else are we going to have to laugh at? Anything... We're not going to laugh at
your
dead wife
yeah.
failing to fulfil the youthful potential that is depicted in this photograph.
I think it's...
What a bachelor party's for, except kicking grieving people while they're down.
Yeah, in fact, when you throw me a bachelor party in the future, that's what I want. I want pictures of my dead wife.
Yeah.
If only she was dead.
And all of his friends, right, all of his friends, I want him to snap out of it. You know what, let's get Spader on. He needs to snap out of this, like, obsession with his dead wife. Well, how are we going to do that? Well, make sure you put a picture of his dead wife in the slideshow.
That'll snap him right out.
Yeah, that'll. Yeah.
Oh, and make him go get the burgers, because there's nothing he likes more than errands.
And he came in with like 50. He came in with 50 burgers, because he came in. And
there
he
was
went,
this whole.
Hey, there's
thing.
All these empty boxes. Like, okay. And then he goes back to the diner. And goes, I bought 50 burgers, and six of the boxes were empty. It looked like you bought six burgers and all the boxes. It looked like whoever you had working on props that day got fired.
Right.
In fact, whoever did the props in the movie should have gotten fired, because all around, I've never been more aware of somebody going, oh, I think the toothpaste would go here. Do you know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. It was so phony. Her, like, gribbly pad. It was another one of those, like, oh, she lives in a tiny shack. You know, looks like a really nice big house in a pretty peaceful location in the backyard, doesn't it? You know what I mean? It was one of those. It didn't look like skanky.
No, but I think that may have been Spader's thought behind the sandwich. He was like, we really have to overly emphasize the rankness of this place. How about I waft the sandwich?
But why did we watch this? Why did you make me watch this movie? There were other Spader films out there. And I know you know that you're busy, but you can't tell me that in between the credits of White Palace rolling and us sitting here today, that you haven't watched 72 films. One of them could have been any other Spader film that didn't involve...
I haven't watched 72 kind of a, films. I barely... I thought we'd have more to talk about.
But what's there to talk about in the movie?
Well, exactly. Like, why the movie even got... I didn't expect you to be like, well, in the book, I'm sure it was much better, so therefore there's our explanation. Like, I expected there to be more speculation.
Oh, I see. Well, unfortunately, I can't see anything to speculate about, because anything that didn't work, it seems to me, doesn't work. Because when you translate a book from a movie, you're trying to... Usually, when you're translating a book to a movie, right, you can't just film what happens in the book, because that's not going to work. You try and capture, like, that... Whatever the mood that the book evokes in people when they read it, right? And you've got to use the same characters and broadly the same plot points. But how they, you know, knit together in order to create the same mood in a viewer that a reader gets is a whole different kettle of fish.
Here's a question.
And it's quite difficult to do.
Here's a question.
All right.
Had there been, and bear with me here, but had there been more ridiculous bonking?
Yes.
Like, instead of just the two sequences, which one we'll call the sandwich sequence and move on, and the other one we'll call the...
There was a lot of montages. There was way too many montages.
Well, there was the run back into the house after going out to work.
Oh, yeah.
Which, I have to say, Spader didn't sell. Like, there was no idea that I was like, he really can't leave her.
Yeah.
It was done very kind of casually.
Yeah.
And then there was, like, one montage where, you know, they're having, like, ridiculous, you know, her legs up in the air under the covers, and he looks to be about 3 feet above her, and, you know, they're just kind of, like, they might as well be two boars in a sack.
Right.
I felt like they didn't have chemistry in that sense. Like, I felt like they were both really good in the movie, and I think you're right, but I don't think they had that chemistry where it was...
Yeah, actually, you're right, because it needs to be the other way around, didn't it? Because in terms of the characters, they need to have sexual chemistry, but no personal chemistry. But in fact, in the movie, they've got no sexual chemistry, but lots of personal chemistry. In other words, when they were sitting just talking to each other, there was this deep connection.
Right.
And when they were being, like, all randy, there was none. And it needed to be exactly the opposite way around.
Right. And I think there needed to be sequences where, like, I don't know, they couldn't, like, help themselves in public. Not, like, full-blown, but, like, you know, little, like, flirtatious things or grabbing each other's crotches or whatever it is. Like, there needed to be more of that. I needed to see more sex.
Or
I just that sounds wrong, but there needed to be more erotic. Because you're right, the front cover of the DVD is more erotic than anything that happens.
Yeah,
in the movie.
Looks like it's going to be like some kind of erotic thriller or romance or something. But it's just like another movie.
Right.
It's fine. It's just.
I just don't think they established. Well, because the whole thing is, I think. And I would have to say, like, 27 is almost too old. But I think there is a point where you're younger as a guy.
Yeah.
That your idea, or certain, no, not your idea, because I think if you're fairly honest to yourself, you fall for or am involved with whoever you want to be. But I think there's certainly that pressure, or certainly that idea that... whether it's put about by advertising or put about by movies or put about by peer pressure, that the woman you're with or the person you're with should be this, like, idyllic, like, image of perfection based purely on looks, and that the attaining of that is somehow correct and means you're popular and means you're intelligent and means you're sexy and means you're all those things. And that if you fall for, or if you find attractive, or if you have chemistry with someone who doesn't fit that bit, then the peer pressure and the awkwardness and the embarrassment of that, you know, would be an area for drama, let's say. But the trouble is that there's only so far you can go down that road before your leading male protagonist looks like an absolute shallow ass who cares more about what his idiot mother thinks than what the girl he's in love with. And the further you go down that road, you have to display and explain as best you can the chemistry and the attraction and the da-da-da-da-da. And I think the other problem with casting Spader is that he doesn't feel like he's comfortable at any point. Like, he's not comfortable when he's alone with her, but he's not comfortable when he's with her with other people. He's not comfortable when he's alone with other people. Spader always plays, you know, a slightly alien character who doesn't feel like he's comfortable with any kind of surroundings.
No, he was an odd choice.
That makes it very difficult. Thank you, sir. Thank
I wonder if they couldn't get, like, Andrew McCarthy or someone, you know? Like, they were clearly going for boyish.
Do you think they went to McCarthy and McCarthy went, sorry, mate, I've that ship sailed, I've done that.
Yeah. Why, did he?
Well, he did, like, you know, Sonoma's Fire and stuff, where he plays, like, the tortured, confused, boyish.
Right, but when yeah, I mean... Yeah.
He, of course, also made the film Class, where he had an affair with an older woman. Okay, she was meant to be a beautiful one and was Rob Lowe's mother in the movie, played by Jacqueline Bisset. But still, older woman, younger boyish boy, I feel like McCarthy has sort of been there, done that.
I don't know. I mean, it was fine.
You know, Andrew McCarthy was in a movie with Nigel Havers.
That I can believe, yeah.
He was. He was in a movie, Nigel Havers, and
I think...
I
bet it was like mid-90s, right?
I think it was directed by, like, Tinto Brass. I think it's like a borderline, like, nudie movie, like a foreign nudie movie.
With Nigel Havers?
Yeah, and I think, yeah, I think it is. I think it's called, like, Last... Why do I remember this? I think it's called, like, Last Days in Clinchy or Last Days in Cleachy or something. It's probably based on some Euro trash novel.
And Nigel Havers, is it?
Nigel Havers and Andrew McCarthy. Yeah. Because Andrew McCarthy was like, wait a minute, I get a free trip to Paris and get to look at a lot of, like, floppy French boobs. Sure, great, sign me up.
The film was actually directed by Claude Chabrol, actually.
So, wait, I have a question for you. What, because I think we should, I do think this is worthwhile, what is Spader's souvenir from this movie? You're going to go with the sandwich, I guess, right?
I think he's probably got the sandwich in, like, a glass display case.
See, I have another
but
theory.
But I also think that V-neck sweater is probably somewhere.
I think, right, that after the movie,
yeah,
he got Susan. This is what I was thinking when I was watching it, because I had to think about something.
Right.
I think he got Susan Sarandon to shave her armpits.
Yeah.
And then I think he made like a false moustache out of the armpit hair, and he used that in like subsequent acting.
Because she does have armpit hair, doesn't she?
And I think he turned up for like auditions, you know,
yeah,
with his like false moustache, knowing that he was wearing Susan Sarandon's armpit hair and getting like a really gross thrill out of it. You know, I mean, like a really sleazy thrill.
And then when the director was like, are you going to have that moustache in the movie? He's like, oh, no, I'm not going to wear it here in the
just
film.
Just audition. It brings me strength.
You're right, he has a false moustache.
False moustache that is made out of Sarandon's
armpit hair. That is on a little velveteen pillow,
yes,
in a harmonica box.
Definitely. That is where it is.
Like, yes, an old, like, 1920s wooden harmonica box.
Yes.
With, like, a velveteen cushion inside.
Yes. But I agree, he does have the sandwich and, like, a, you know, vacuum. What are they called? The vacuum?
Vacuum, what? No, it's just in a glass display case.
Well, like, slowly mouldering.
Yeah, oh, definitely. And probably hung on it, like, it's a straight frame, but it's hung in the frame at an angle.
On a bleak angle.
At a, yeah.
Or maybe it's on a bit of string, so it's perpetually wafting.
Yes.
Perpetual. And he calls it like the perpetual waft of the sex sandwich.
That's the tagline.
The perpetual waft of the sex sandwich.
Sex sandwich. That's it.
In fact, that could be his autobiography. That could be a title of his autobiography. James Spader, the perpetual waft of the sex sandwich.
The perpetual foppish waft. Or is that too much? Perpetual foppish waft.
Perpetual waft of the half-eaten sex sandwich.
No, don't act. I think we had it right first time.
Perpetual waft of the sex sandwich.
Of the sex sandwich. Because that sounds like, you know, motorbike maintenance for the soul or whatever. You know, like, it sounds like one of those.
Okay. Well, that's my
book title.
That's my bet. Sandwich and false moustache.
False moustache made out of armpit hair. Yeah, that might be right. Might be right. And was the armpit hair a way to make it like, well, she's Susan Sarandon, but she has armpit hair. Was it a way?
I think, again, I don't know.
Because, again, I don't understand why someone who, like, okay, this is the other difficulty, and this is where you're right. That character should be someone who isn't so glamorous, because then she's trying her whole time to be glamorous. With Sarandon, you have to dull her down.
Yeah. Yeah, see, that's...
And therefore, the whole Marilyn Monroe fixation thing doesn't quite work.
Yeah,
because,
it's not as like,
because
sad.
You're like, how do we grubby up Sarandon rather than try and beautify someone who isn't, like, ugly, you know, nose all over her face, but, like, you know, someone who's just not Susan Sarandon.
Someone who, if they were, like, you know, in their mid-40s... And
Kathy Bates, for example.
Right. And is, like, attempting to strike Marilyn Monroe poses for Spader. And it's all a bit, like, you know, like, pathetic, bordering on comic, but also kind of very human.
Right.
Kind of relatable.
Right.
And to find... For him to find this person, like, irresistible, like, yeah, sexually irresistible, which is what she wants to be, for them to kind of have this, you know, that's an interesting relationship.
Who else around that time could you have cast? I mean, you've got Susan Sarandon. I tell you who you could have done it with, and although she is a very beautiful woman, she could also, like, do it a little better. You could have done Barbara Hershey, because she's not, like, as striking.
She's too bony. Hershey's, yeah, too bony.
What about Hershey with some weight on her?
Well, because I feel like the reason, again, I don't know, but if she's a waitress in a fast food chain who idolises Marilyn Monroe, I'm going to say she's a little bit on the porky side.
Right.
Like, as in, not, like, fat, but, you know, Marilyn was, like, a curvy woman.
Right, no, and Sarandon at least has, like...
And I think that's why Sarandon's better than Hershey. Okay. I think she's got to be, you know, curvy.
No, I was just trying to think of people who are...
I think you're right. I think Bates would have been better. I think, actually, the story really should have been, in the book,
yeah,
now that I think about it, the story is really Bates,
yeah,
and Costanza.
Right.
That's the story. Imagining a romance between George Costanza and Kathy Bates.
Right.
That is the story. If you read a book about that, where they managed to make that convincing, that would be really something. But you wouldn't want to watch that in a movie.
Well, Costanza's too old, I think. Alexander seems too old in the movie.
Is he too old? I guess he probably is a little bit, yeah.
It needs to be, because it needs to be...
Well, what about that friend of his with the unbelievable dress sense?
he's supposed to be the same age as Spader.
Who was very boyish.
Yeah, he was like a very boyish Jewish guy with like a really loud waistcoat and really loud shirt.
I can't even think.
He comes up to her and tries to like flirt with her at the Thanksgiving dinner.
Oh, right, yeah. No, he's not got the right look. Not him.
No, maybe not. Like a young Paul Reiser. That could work.
Yeah. But you have to, like...
He's too old.
Reiser, even in Beverly Hills Cop, looks too old.
Yeah, he is. He's a middle-aged man. I don't know.
But yeah, no, I mean, Reiser and Bates would at least be a more interesting movie.
It should have been Bates. Bates isn't vulnerable. You need her to be, like... very vulnerable and insecure.
You don't think Bates could play vulnerable?
I don't think Bates could do vulnerable. I think she does brassy and uncompromised.
Kathy Bates, brassy and uncompromised. The Kathy Bates story. Yeah, I guess so. I don't know who else has. There isn't really anyone else around, is there?
I mean, he's weathered and plump and blonde, really. Like bleach blonde. Probably phony.
Is that in the book? Have you read the book? Is this one of your favourite books?
Listen, I would be surprised, think of it this way, in the book, right? Forget the movie. I'd be surprised that if he comes across a woman who's obsessed with Marilyn Monroe,
right,
she wouldn't have bleach blonde hair. I don't know why she wouldn't.
I guess so.
You know what I mean? It just seems daft. The only reason they didn't do it is I'm guessing like Sarandon looks weird with bleach blonde hair. It maybe looks too glamorous. Usually they like to make...
They should have like dirty blonded up her hair. Like not bleached it,
but yeah,
like
they could have done that.
Dirty blonde.
Yeah, like mousy. They could have mousy blonded it all over the shop.
Yeah, they didn't. They didn't mousy blonde it all over the shop. That was really the problem.
So I guess the point here is that I'm hoping for more sleaze next time.
Right. So I felt that there was...
I think there was a requisite amount of sleaze.
I felt that there was just the sexual aspect of the movie was like added to the sleaze factor.
It wasn't nearly sleazy enough for Sleazy Spader Springtime.
I don't know.
You talk about a man who makes a generic, straight-ahead, faintly silly sci-fi thriller into some kind of mad sleaze fest just by being in it.
Right.
Like, there's a power of Spader.
There is,
that manages
right.
to, like, transform everything around him with this, like, flood of invisible sleaze.
And so do you think the problem with this one is that he's meant to be erotically charged and therefore somehow it decharges his eroticism?
Yes, I think you're right, yeah.
Whereas if he was an accountant who really all he had to do was, like, buy bagels or something, buying bagels as an accountant, the sexiest thing you'd ever
seen.
That's
why he's so great in Secretary, because he's like sitting there supposedly being normal. And then when you find out that he's a huge sexual demon, you go, well, of course he is.
Right.
That makes sense.
Right.
You know, because he's sitting there doing normal things.
Spader.
Being really sleazy.
Spader, here's another judge based on 2 Days in the Valley, which we've both seen.
Although not for a long time. I can watch 2 Days in the Valley again.
He's not a main enough part in it. Okay. And there's other ones that I want to watch as well. But anyway, but yeah, maybe that's a backup, maybe. But in 2 Days in the Valley, right, where he plays a sleazy hitman.
Right. See, right there, he's playing a sleazy hitman.
The thing in that...
I feel like we need to watch 2 Days in the
Valley. I feel like he's a hitman in that movie, and that's how it's written. And the whole bit with, like, Charlize Theron, where he's, like, being ridiculous and sleazy and sexual and all the rest of it. I feel like, much like John Cusack demands to wear a Ramones t-shirt, a black baseball cap, and mumble about Hunter S. Thompson in every single film that he's now in, I feel like back in the day, Spader was like, I'm not doing it unless there's some outrageously sleazy moment where for some reason I'm having it away with Charlize Theron. Which, by the way, like, Charlize Theron, like, back at the prime beginning of her career and Spader just being weird. Like, how did that ever happen? Anyway.
I can't remember. I can't remember the movie. It's been so long since I saw it.
He plays a ginger bespectacled hitman.
Don't tell me, because I quite want to see it.
Okay, but I don't think there's enough Spader in it to qualify for a sleazy Spader.
All right. Maybe.
Because there's also a lot of that screaming British guy who thinks he's Richard E. Grant, but he isn't, and that's kind of irritating.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
You remember? And you're like, why didn't they just cast Richard E. Grant? What, like Grant was busy? Grant's never busy.
Yeah.
Because everyone else in that movie is really lovely. Like, Danny Aiello puts on a really great performance. The old dude who's a writer, who's like the schlubby writer guy with the dog and stuff, he's really good in it. Spader's great in it. But, like, that whiny English dude just needs to be shot in the face.
Did he Chris Tucker the movie?
Oh, he Chris Tuckered the fuck out of the movie.
It's such a shame when that happens.
Right?
What we need is a bit of colour, a splash of joie de vivre,
and vibrancy, yeah.
And vibrancy, that's what this needs. A bit of joy, a bit of bounce. Bring me the most annoying human on earth.
Anyway, don't bother seeing White Palace.
Do not see White Palace. Do not see it.
We'll pick a much better film next week.
He'd better. I didn't have anything to do with this. I wiped my hands of that.
I think we did pretty well with it. I think it's a pretty entertaining
episode. Glad I saw it. And I did it. I will say this, weird enough, I actually enjoyed the... While I was watching the film, I was enjoying myself, while at the same time realising that this was not a good film.
I remember...
And not in an ironic way, but just like, my time is being stolen away, but...
I remember getting to the end of it and going... Much like you did. Like, I know what they were going for. Like a Bukowski slice of life kind of story about how judgmental the upper middle classes are. But, like, ultimately, you get to the end and you're like, well, but why was any of that?
I didn't care about him. I don't know. But
I think she acted as well as she could to make her as... ballsy as she needed to be, but as pathetic as she needed to be. And there were moments where, I mean, if anyone walks away with a film, it has to be Sarandon. She is very good in the movie, considering I understand the miscasting thing that we're talking about in terms of looks. But I think in terms of sheer performance, she is the best thing in the film.
Yeah, I would go along with that. I mean, I think Spader's good. It's just that he's, if possible, even more miscast now, because actually she can play what she needs to play.
Right.
But she looks all wrong.
Right.
He looks all wrong, and I think he's the wrong guy for it as well, because he doesn't... There's no sense
you're right.
of Spader
think,
being vulnerable.
I think we have cracked the Spader code, and that is... If he is expected to be sleazy, or it's about eroticism, then it's going to fail.
Yeah.
But if it's about a normal person on the cusp of sexuality, on the edge of eroticism, on the weird, like, perverted kind of dark corners, then he excels.
I think Spader is, like...
Oh, and he could also...
In terms of, like, the cultural, you know, subconscious, he is, like, the reflection of our darkest perverted...
Yeah. Like, he can make the sipping...
Every time we've daydreamed about something, like, weird and sexy in the middle of a boring meeting, like, we're basically being Spader. Like, that's
I would imagine...
He embodies that, like...
I would imagine Spader...
Thinking about something filthy when we shouldn't.
I imagine he goes up on the roof of his apartment building in New York every day and gets into some position that only we can imagine, like some naked position. And the light is cast from him and somehow... sexual energy and perverted thoughts, much like the ghosts in Ghostbusters at the end where they come through and blow out the window, I imagine they're more like kind of perverted cum ghosts from Spader's
backwards. I feel it's more likely that he owns like a pigeon and he gets naked and then rubs pigeons on himself. Yeah, he runs around and he gets sweaty and then rubs himself with pigeons and then lets them loose upon the city.
Yeah.
And then they, because they're quite sleazy, kind of disgusting,
kind of
scratchy
disgusting
creatures.
Animals,
and they're just like dripping like Spader's sleaze all over the city.
That might be a good
That is my that's my best guess.
Who can tell? So the sleaze armor on this is
pretty low.
Yeah, I would say like the first half, you're probably getting a good kind of 4 out of 10.
Really?
4 out of 10? That's not a high mark.
I'd say 3 at best.
No, in the first half, where he's like being naked and wafting a sandwich.
It's still not very sleazy, though. He's just bonking something.
You're right. The thing with Spader is he can make eating a toasted bagel obscene.
Yeah.
He can make sipping... I think there's a scene in The Blacklist where he sips a very tiny cappuccino. Or an espresso, rather, in like a tiny, tiny cup while wearing an enormous hat and a wafty scarf. And he might as well have just been performing grotesque cunnilingus on a horse.
Like, that's probably what he was thinking about. jelly. He's probably got a picture of it at the bottom of his tiny coffee cup. Every single coffee cup in Spader's kitchen, right, has got like a sick sexual photograph at the bottom of it. So every time he finishes cappuccino, he's like, horse-fighting or whatever. That's what it'll be.
Yeah, definitely. I think
dwarf
you're right.
Tossing.
And with that, what was the tagline again?
Something about the something wafting of a sexual sandwich.
It's all right. I'll listen to it back again.
Perpetual waft of a sex of a sex sandwich.
Perpetual waft of a sex sandwich. Yeah, which would be the new like the businessman toy that they have on like a desk that has like a swinging thing or like a pick your answer yes or no whatever those things are. The businessmen have like little marble games or whatever. The Spader just has the perpetual waft of the sex sandwich on some sort of like angle poised.
Yeah, and it's pornographic cappuccino mugs. Espresso mugs. Pornographic espresso mugs.
Okay, well, with that, James, thank you so much for being on the After Movie Diner.
Thank you very much for having me.
And we will be back next week.
You've been listening to the After Movie Diner with your host, Jon Cross.
Some of them dream.